God bless the great state of Oklahoma. What a blessing to be here with Patriots. What a blessing to start with the incredible musical talent of Twyla Paris and Kathy Costello. What a privilege to be with Pastor Paul Blair. What a voice for America is David Barton. And how about Governor Fallon? What a blessing for the governor to be here and to welcome me here to the great state of Oklahoma. And how about Glenn Beck? Isn't Glenn extraordinary? Every time I listen to Glenn, I learn from him. Every time. Glenn is an educator. I love when he pulls out the whiteboard. When he begins walking through the principles of the framers that founded the Constitution, that founded this nation, that built this nation. And when he talks about the perils of progressivism. As you guys know, you can have progressives be, they can be Democrats or Republicans. You know, Reagan said, the scariest words in the English language are, I'm from the government, I'm here to help you. You want an easy definition for a progressive? Someone that doesn't understand why those words are so terrifying. And you know, remember a couple of years ago when Glenn was talking about the coming Islamic caliphate? And people dismissed him as some crazy right-wing kook. Man, I can't imagine what that feels like. But then as we see ISIS rear its ugly head, declare a caliphate, we realize that speaking the truth has power. And I am so proud to be standing here with Glenn Beck and standing here with each of you patriots who love this country. All of us are here today because America's in crisis. Because we're bankrupting our kids and grandkids. Because our constitutional rights are under assault each and every day. And because America has receded from leadership in the world. And yet I'm here today with a word of hope and encouragement and exhortation all across Oklahoma, all across this country. People are waking up, and there is a spirit of awakening sweeping this nation. I believe this election in 2016 is going to come down to three key issues: jobs, freedom, and security. Let's talk about jobs. For 7 years, we've been trapped in the Obama-Clinton stagnation. If you're a single mom, if you're working 28, 29 hours a week, forcibly reduced part-time because Obamacare kicks in at 30 hours. If you're a working man and woman with calluses on your hand who's seen your wages stagnate for the last decade going nowhere under the Obama economy. If you're a young person coming out of school with student loans up to your eyeballs, scared, am I going to get a job? If I do, what does the future hold? Will I be able to provide for my family? What we're doing now isn't working. And you know, it's real easy to talk about making America great again. You can even print that on a baseball cap. But the real question is, do you understand the principles and values that made America great in the first place? The key to our economy is small business. Small business is the heart of the economy. I grew up in Texas as the son of two small business owners in the oil and gas industry. You want to hammer the economy, hammer small businesses like we've seen the last 7 years. You'll get what we got now, misery, stagnation, malaise. On the flip side, you want to unleash the economy, lift the burdens on small businesses, take the boot of the federal government off the backs of the necks of small businesses. If I am elected president, we will repeal every word of Obamacare. We'll pass common sense health care reform that makes health insurance personal and portable and affordable and keeps government from getting in between us and our doctors. And we will adopt a simple flat tax. Where every American can fill out our taxes on a postcard. And when we do that, we should abolish the IRS. For far too long, we've had deal makers in Washington, politicians who cut deals with the Democrats, who grow the debt, who grow regulation, who take away our liberties, that helps the giant corporations, it helps the lobbyists, and it leaves the working men and women of this country in the dust. You know, no issue illustrates that more powerfully than immigration. Immigration. In a Republican primary, everyone talks a good game on immigration. But if you want to know where someone stands, you need look no further than where they stood in 2013 over the battle of the Gang of Eight amnesty bill. In that battle, one senator, Senator Marco Rubio, made the decision to stand with Barack Obama and Harry Reid and Chuck Schumer and author a massive amnesty bill in the United States Congress. I made a very different decision. I made the decision to stand with millions of Americans and say, this will not stand, and we defeated amnesty in Congress. Now, a third candidate, Donald Trump. I'm told he talks a fair amount about immigration. But it's a very interesting question. Where was he in 2013? You know where he was? He was funding the Gang of Eight. Donald Trump gave over $50,000 to five of the eight members of the Gang of Eight. Let me tell you something. When you've spent 40 years giving money to open border Democrats, you don't get to campaign as someone who's going to secure the border. If I'm elected president, we are going to build a wall. And I've got someone in mind to build it. We're going to triple the Border Patrol. We're going to increase fourfold the fixed wing and rotary wing aircraft. We're going to end sanctuary cities. We're going to end welfare benefits for people here illegally. And let me tell you what we're going to see. We're going to see more and more jobs for American citizens. We're going to see wages going up. We're going to see people here illegally not driving down your wages and taking your jobs. We're going to see rule of law and national security being protected. And when we repeal Obamacare and pass a flat tax, we're going to see small businesses explode. Millions and millions of high-paying jobs, wages going up, young people coming out of school with two, three, four, 5 job offers. That's what this election is about, the future that we're giving to our kids and grandkids. The second thing this election is going to be about is freedom, our basic constitutional liberties. You know, 2 weeks ago, when Justice Scalia passed away, it underscored for people all across Oklahoma, all across this country, the stakes of this election. Last week, I went to Justice Scalia's funeral. I had the privilege of knowing Justice Scalia personally for 20 years. He was a lion of the law. He ferociously defended the Bill of Rights and the Constitution. And it underscored his passing that this election is not one branch of government, but two branches of government hanging in the balance. We are one justice away, one liberal justice away from a 5-justice left-wing majority, the likes of which this country's never seen. We are one justice away from the Supreme Court concluding that your religious liberty can be taken away and the government can force you to violate your faith on pain of fine or prisons. We are one justice away from the Supreme Court ordering 10 Commandments monuments to be torn down all over this country. We are one liberal justice away from the Supreme Court effectively erasing the Second Amendment from the Bill of Rights and holding that no American has any individual right to keep and bear arms whatsoever. We are one liberal justice away from the Supreme Court ordering veterans' memorials with any religious symbols torn down all over this country. And we are one liberal justice away from the Supreme Court subjecting us to the authority of the World Court and the United Nations and international law and undermining American sovereignty. You know, last week at the debate, there was a powerful moment of clarity. When Hugh Hewitt asked about religious liberty and Donald Trump said to me, Ted, you got to be willing to compromise. You got to be willing to give in to the Democrats and work with them. Well, let me be very clear to the people of Oklahoma. I will not compromise and give up your religious liberty. And I will not compromise and give up your Second Amendment right to keep and bear arms. And Donald Trump is telling us his plan. His plan is to sit down with Harry Reid and Chuck Schumer and reach an agreement on a justice to replace Antonin Scalia. Well, let me tell you, if we reach that agreement, your rights and my rights will be lost for a generation. And I believe the decision that the voters in Oklahoma and across this country are making as they look at that debate stage is, who do I know, beyond a shadow of a doubt, who do I know will get it right on the Supreme Court? And I give you my word, every justice I put on the court will be faithful to the Constitution and will defend the Bill of Rights for your children and mine. And the third critical issue in this election is security. For 7 years, we've had a president that has abandoned and alienated our friends and allies and has shown weakness and appeasement to our enemies. Again, in the debate last week, we had a clarifying moment when Donald Trump said if he was president, he would be neutral between Israel and the Palestinians. Well, look, it shouldn't be surprising. Liberal New York Democrats like Hillary have said that for many, many years. Let me be abundantly clear. If I am president, I will not be neutral. America will stand unapologetically with the nation of Israel. One of the most dismaying things that has happened over the last 7 years has been the weakening of our military. The lessening of readiness, the collapse of morale, 7 years of a commander-in-chief who doesn't believe in the mission of our military, who undermines them at every step. Now, we have an historical parallel for that. The Jimmy Carter administration did the same thing to the military, weakened this country. And what did Reagan do? He came in. He passed tax reform and regulatory reform. Small businesses took off and exploded, generated trillions in new revenue, millions of new jobs. That revenue Reagan used to rebuild the military, and we bankrupted the Soviet Union and won the Cold War. I intend to do the exact same thing with radical Islamic terrorism. We are going to rebuild our military and ensure that it remains the mightiest fighting force on the face of the planet. No longer is the United States military going to be governed by political correctness. We will have a commander-in-chief who says to the world, we will defeat radical Islamic terrorism. We'll have a president willing to utter the words, radical Islamic terrorism. And you know, one of the most shameful aspects of the last 7 years has been this president sending our fighting men and women into combat with rules of engagement that tie their arms behind their back and make it impossible for them to defend themselves and defeat the enemy. That is wrong. It is immoral. And mark my words, in January 2017, it will end. America's always been reluctant to use military force. We are slow to anger. But if and when military force is needed, we should use overwhelming force, kill the enemy, and then get the heck out of there. And let me speak to every soldier, sailor, airman, and marine. Let me speak to every mom and dad, every sister and brother, every son and daughter of a fighting man and woman. For 7 years, you've had a commander-in-chief who doesn't believe you, who doesn't support you. On January 20th, 2017, you have my solemn commitment. I will have your back. Now, some of y'all might be thinking, can we do this? Can it happen? You know, Scripture tells us there's nothing new under the sun. I think where we are today is very, very much like the late 1970s, the Jimmy Carter administration. Same failed economic policies. Same feckless and naive foreign policies. In fact, the exact same countries, Russia and Iran, openly laughing at and mocking the President of the United States. Now, why is it that that analogy gives me so much hope and optimism? Because we remember how that story ended. All across this country, millions of men and women rose up and became the Reagan Revolution. And it didn't come from Washington. Washington despised Ronald Reagan. You know, every candidate in the Republican field says they'll stand up to Washington. The natural follow-up question is, okay, when have you ever stood up to Washington? When have you taken on not just Democrats, but leaders in your own party? You want to know who'll stand up to Washington? Ask yourself one question. Who is Washington attacking? We are 2 days away from Super Tuesday. Super Tuesday, I believe, will be the most important day in this entire primary season. And I'll tell you, Oklahoma is a battleground. We are neck and neck. You know, 65% of Republican primary voters don't think Donald Trump is the right candidate to go head-to-head with Hillary Clinton. Recognize that Donald Trump as the nominee means Hillary probably wins and we lose this country. If you're one of those 65% here at home, I ask you, stand with us. What is unquestionably clear, looking at the first four races, our campaign is the only campaign that has beaten Donald Trump and that can beat Donald Trump. Here in Oklahoma, we're neck and neck with Donald. So, at folks at home, if you're thinking of supporting another candidate, listen, there are good people in this race, people I like, people I respect. But the only candidate in a position to beat Donald here in Oklahoma and across the country on Super Tuesday is us. And so if you don't want Donald to be the nominee, stand united with us. And let me tell you the power of this campaign. Look around. It is the men and women here. This is a grassroots campaign. This campaign is going to be won not on television, not on radio. It is going to be won friend to friend, neighbor to neighbor, pastor to pastor, Oklahoman to Oklahoman. And so I ask every one of you for the next 48 hours to pick up the phone, to call your friends, to call your family, to call your neighbors, to call your coworkers, to call anyone and everyone you can in Oklahoma or any other Super Tuesday state and say, this election matters. It's me, it's my family, it's my children, it's my grandchildren. Let's stand together. It took Jimmy Carter to give us Ronald Reagan. And I am convinced the most long-lasting legacy of Barack Obama is going to be a new generation of leaders in the Republican Party who stand and fight for liberty, who stand and fight for the Constitution, and who stand and fight for the Judeo-Christian values that built this great nation. Thank you, and God bless you.